Welcome back to the SFOM channel and thanks for tuning in. This video will be a little bit different from all of my other videos. So normally I talk about amateur astrophotography and what kind of equipment I use and what kind of software I use and the steps you need to take to engage in this wonderful hobby. But this video will be about Starlink, and it's actually with a heavy heart that I talk about Starlink, but I think it is necessary to do so. Important to mention is that this video will be very boring. And it is actually with a heavy heart that I make this video, because SpaceX, I had this company in my mind, they were really heroes. SpaceX is a US-based for-profit company which is developing a space-based Starlink system. Initially, they will launch 12,000 satellites into low Earth orbit at 550 kilometers altitude. But the entire system will consist of satellites at varying altitudes of 340, 550 and 1150 kilometers. The Federal Communication Commission in the US, they already approved the deployment of 12,000 Starlink satellites, which will orbit the Earth and are visible for all mankind to see. And apparently no international approval was necessary. Interesting. SpaceX plans to further increase the number of satellites to 42,000 in the next decade. And other competitors like the Amazon Kuiper project, Facebook, Roscosmos and OneWeb, they all have similar plans. Which could bring the total number of satellites in so-called low Earth orbit, which means below 1500 kilometers in altitude, to more than 50,000. The arguments being used for its necessity are that it will provide the world population with worldwide access to broadband internet. And the main reasoning behind this, and I totally get that by the way, is that broadband internet has become a basic human need in the 21st century. So if you want access to information, if you want to get an education, if you want to get a job or perform your job, if you want to get access to services, You depend heavily on internet for those things. And also we have the Internet of Things, so all kinds of smart devices which are being connected to the internet. So they also depend on having a high-speed internet connection. So no arguments from me there. I really see that internet has become a basic human need in the 21st century. There are huge differences between developed and developing nations in worldwide internet connectivity. And often I see in all of those tech channels, they say that only 50% has access to internet. Yeah, that's true, but you should also look at where those people live. So 87% in the developed nations, they already have access to internet and also broadband internet. And only 47% of the people living in developing nations have access to internet. If you look at the particular nations who lack internet, then we are talking about 28% of the people having an internet connection in African nations, 51% in Arab states, and 48.4% in the Asia and Pacific nations. A very important question then to ask yourself, and I don't see this anywhere on the internet, is what is the main cause for the lack of access to internet? So everybody just assumes, or a lot of channels I watch, they just assume that the lack of internet access is because there's no infrastructure available. Huh? There's no technical infrastructure, and space-based communication will provide that infrastructure. So I've been looking at some reports on, and this is a case study report of the World Bank, so I would trust this source, on broadband networks in the Middle East and Northern Africa. What are their findings and what are their statements being made in that report? And I just quote them here. So on page 59 and page 60, it says that in the Middle Eastern and Northern Africa, or the MENA regions in short, surprise, surprise, there is already good international connectivity, with the vast majority of traffic transferred internationally through submarine cables with terrestrial fiber. So basically this means that we have fiber optic cables running from Europe and coming from Asia probably, that connect the Arab states and also the Northern African nations to high-speed internet. And then a second issue is, of course, whether or not these networks are also being rolled out locally into their own country. An increasing share of data traffic is transferred nationally, so within those countries, through terrestrial fiber, with microwave and satellite transmissions accounting for a steadily decreasing amount. So you can see that microwave and satellite transmission, so mobile communication and satellite-based communications, they have been going down, not up in these nations, down, because the fiber optic network infrastructure is rolled out. And more people get access to fast speed internet via that network. Obviously, there's no particular mention in those countries about the absolute need for broadband space-based communication systems. Just important to say, I think. So why aren't these people connected if the infrastructure is there? So it specifically states here, it's on the conclusion section on page 127, to reap these benefits, the MENA countries should fully open up their broadband markets to competition. The gap between MENA and regions with higher broadband diffusion is mainly a gap in market structure. Not a technical problem, not technical infrastructure, market structure, competition and governance. So let's continue here. A commitment to open markets means enforcing a deep regulatory reform, introducing measures to strengthen competition, eliminating monopolies, licensing more operators, tackling dominant positions, and lowering explicit and regulatory barriers to entry. This kind of reform almost always involves addressing local resistance to change, often coming from those economic and political agents that are profiting from existing rents. This is a tall order indeed. So let's what do they mean by this? It just means that there's an oligarchy or a monopoly on these technical networks. So there's maybe one state-owned company, or maybe one or two or three companies that own the entire network, and they fix their prices basically. So they do not open up that network to other companies that can compete for lower prices for an internet connection. And so those prices are still artificially very high, and people can just not afford being connected to internet. So this is not a technical problem. It's a problem about protectionism, about a few people having the power and the access to the internet network and not willing to share that with other competitors. These developing nations, they are really protectionistic about their markets. But so the first market is, of course, the US, and maybe also within Europe. Those markets will become available. But then the competition is fierce there, because about 80 to 85% of the US citizens, they already have access to internet and broadband internet. And then the question is also why these other 15 to 20% of those of people, why that 20% is not connected? Is that actually a technical problem, or is it because they lack the economic means to get access to internet? So for instance, if you lose your job and you lose your healthcare in the United States, you also lose your healthcare when you lose your job. I think one of the first things you will kick out is maybe that expensive internet connection bill that you get every month. So maybe there's also more of an economic problem than a technical problem. This is just my guess. I didn't do any research. So also another guess is that Starlink 10 will serve maybe about 10% of the local population, or at least the United States citizens. And also, of course, Starlink will ask for a monthly subscription cost, right? It will cost maybe about $80 to get subscribed to Starlink, just as any other telecom provider. And we are not aware of any, what kind of services will they offer? We don't know. We have to wait and see. Now, let's look at other markets that Starlink will be looking for. So the European market is also very tough, I think, because about 85% of the population here already has broadband internet access. The EU will also regulate, I think, the market to avoid monopolies. So it will be very hard, I think, for SpaceX to serve a lot of European citizens. But yeah, I don't know, I could be completely wrong. I'm not an expert on this. And then actually the nations who need it the most are the developing nations, of course. So North Africa, Middle East, China, Asia, Russia, etc. The main issue, like I showed you here, seems to be not technical, but it seems to be market protectionism by a few companies, a few state-owned companies who have total control of the network. Yeah. So if those governments are not willing to open up their networks to other companies right now, I think probably they would not open up their markets to SpaceX's Starlink system. So we're not talking about providing broadband internet access to developing nations, at least not as long as these governments are not allowing SpaceX to enter that market. And of course, I think the subscription cost will be reasonably high because it will be an expensive system to maintain. So the question is also whether or not people could really economically afford Starlink in developing nations. So then, I think then the question becomes different, because then the question will be, are we willing to give up the night sky for a handful of US and maybe also EU-based venture capitalist companies who will only serve about maybe 10% of the Western maybe population? And of course, maybe I'm also wrong. Maybe space-based communications will still become the dominant form of internet use. It might happen because I cannot see into the future. I can only look into the past as an amateur astrophotographer. But this also raises questions, I think. It also makes you think, are you willing to accept that only a handful of companies like Amazon, SpaceX, Facebook will dominate this market without any real competition? Because it's very expensive to launch these space-based test satellite systems. So we only will have a handful of companies that which will be able to afford to build such a system. And then we are completely dependent on those companies, right? So are you willing then to accept maybe price fixing between those companies? Are you willing to abide by the rules they invent on how to pay for internet, how to get access to internet? And also keep in mind that we have had a lot of privacy issues with those giant tech companies. So think about fake news, lack of data protection. Facebook as an example. Maybe for the Star Trek lovers who are already 50 years old, like 45 years old, like I am, do you want to live on Ferenginar? Do you want a system which is based on profits? When you look out there into the universe and into our solar system at night, is the thought mainly which economic resources are there to profit from? Or is the main idea to seek out new life and new civilizations and to understand how the universe works? And of course, both can go hand in hand. I'm not saying that there is any room for I'm not saying that there's not any room for economic competition. That's not true, but it does make you think. So let's wrap up this this presentation, because I'm talking for far too long. So we are looking at about 50,000 satellites in low Earth orbit. Like I said, you can see here the telecom companies, SpaceX being the largest, but also OneWeb, Telesat, Amazon, Link, Facebook, Roscosmos, Aerospace. They are all looking for access they are all looking to build such a system in space. Then from the astronomical side of it, this is maybe a bit much. So yeah, the let's think about the night sky. When you're out there during the night and you look up, the human eye can detect up to 9,000 stars. If you're really at the dark side, I went to Greece last summer, and when you look up, you see the Milky Way, and you really see thousands of stars, and this is an unforgettable experience for me, at least. If you are in a suburban or an urban area, obviously you're not going to see many stars. You maybe be limited to an apparent magnitude of 5 or 4. So this means that you will see hundreds or maybe 1500 stars in the night sky. And if you really live in a city center like me, you may be limited to a couple of hundred stars. Anyway, let's compare that then to the number of satellites that you will be seeing in the next decade. So it's very important to mention that these satellites, they are visible. I have looked at those satellites from SpaceX. Also, the satellites that have reached their orbit, that have been launched last year and have reached their orbit, they are clearly visible. They have a brightness between the 3rd and the 7th magnitude, meaning that we can see them with our eyes and make smartphone videos. They are similar to the brightness of the stars in Ursa Major. Look that up if you're interested and you do not know where the stars are at Ursa Major. Visible to the unaided eye, especially after sunset and before sunrise. So you have to imagine that These satellites, they don't have any lights, but the sun, just after sunset, the sun will shine on the solar panels of those satellites, and the solar panels will then reflect that light onto Earth. And okay, SpaceX lovers will say, from SpaceX, like Starlink 9 launch and onwards, we will have solar shades on those panels. Okay. Let's just wait and see what happens when those solar shades are actually being implemented. We don't know. Right now, we see all of these hundreds of satellites being launched. We can clearly see them. And, you know, we had the same discussion with the oil companies. When the oil companies, they come to your region and they say, oh, we are going to start fracking here, taking the oil out of the ground, but there will not be any environmental impact because we obviously obey by the rules. So this is just company talk. So I'm really surprised that a lot of people are just buying into all of the statements of SpaceX. They are continuing their launch. They are not stopping launches until they have fixed this problem. I don't know who is going to hold them accountable. Apparently no one. And it's not only SpaceX. So SpaceX, okay, I think Elon Musk has good intentions. But we are also talking about Amazon. We're also talking about Facebook. We're also talking about OneWeb. Are all of those CEOs so concerned about an unblemished view of the night sky? Okay, I don't think so. So what are we talking about? These satellites will be brighter than 99% of all the stars that are out there. When the 50K satellites become a reality, there will be a satellite in every degree of arc. So, I just want you to just stretch out your arm, look at your thumb, maybe two thumbs, and then for every two thumbs you look at, just close one eye and then look at these two thumbs, for every two thumbs, there will be a satellite in the night sky. Just think about the what kind of impact that has when you look up. Maybe you will be completely excited, I don't know. But in the Netherlands, the number of UFO sightings have gone through the roof. Also in Belgium, people don't know what kind of thing they are looking at. They are afraid that aliens are invading their country. And then all of the SpaceX lovers out there, which I used to be one of them, they are telling that community that they should be grateful because they just saw the satellite train of Starlink number 6. Unbelievable. Okay. So who will be affected? Well, everybody. So all mankind will be affected. Everybody who wants to look at the night sky for inspiration, for peace, for detachment from the 24/7 economy, for religious purposes, maybe cultural reasons. So a lot of religions and a lot of cultural groups, they really base their traditions on the night sky. I mean, it's not like every day of the week is called after an astronomical object. Monday, Sunday, Saturday, Saturn's Day. Okay. Professional amateur astronomers in the visual light spectrum. So that's me and all my friends, my amateur astrophotography friends. They will be affected because streaks of light will be in your picture of satellites crossing their English as a second language is terrible. So you will be affected because you have streaks of light going through your picture every time a satellite crosses your field of view. So this will affect amateur astrophotography, amateur astronomy, professional astronomy as well. All those ground-based telescopes will have to deal with that nuisance. And the radio spectrum will of course be affected as well because these telecommunication satellites will also communicate using radio signals. And of course we have a lot of radio-based telescopes. Just think about the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. They are really listening to weak signals coming from deep space. But now maybe all they hear is these communication satellites, and of course a lot of actions are being taken to take care of, to ease the radio astronomers' peace of mind. Well, we will see where it goes. Until now, they didn't have any problem, and now they do need to deal with that problem. Let's see. So estimations are that we have a satellite in every degree of arc, like I just showed you, roughly meaning one satellite present in a space that occupies two moons. I just want to state this final piece. So I really see the night sky as a cultural heritage that is freely available for all mankind. And I like this statement. So the sky, our common and universal heritage, is an integral part of the environment perceived by humanity. Humankind has always observed the sky either to interpret it or to understand the physical laws that govern the universe. This interest in astronomy has had profound implications for science, philosophy, religion, culture, and our general conception of the universe. And I really feel like that. So you have to see the sky as a nature park, right? So we have to protect that a little bit, because the night sky is there for all mankind to get inspiration from and to come up with new ideas and to get out of the 24/7 economy. I think it's something we should continue to be able to observe and stand in awe of. Okay. First of all, my personal apologies for this rant, and hopefully when you are still there, you found some useful stuff in there. If not, sorry, I have wasted your time. As said, I have two more videos this week on how to capture a Starlink satellite in the night sky using your amateur astrophotography equipment. That's it. So thanks for watching. Clear skies.